Well, I'm really glad to be here tonight, and I thank Sarah and the library, and of course Evergreen, that they conspired together to get me here. I think we started about a year ago trying to get to Olympia. So I'm very happy to finally be here. I was here once before, a few years ago, really remember it fondly. Well, tonight I want to read the first parts of the first chapter. It's too long to read all of it. and I call this first chapter Follow the Corn. It's of course, the whole book is a history of the United States from the indigenous people's perspective. But I think it's really important to start with what was here before the Europeans came, what was lost in the process of colonization of all the Americas, but then focusing in on what is now the United States. And I think there'll be some things here you may, some of you may know, some of you may not, or you might not put them, put it in the same context or configuration as I have come to imagine it. Humanoids existed on Earth for about 4 million years as hunters and gatherers living in small communal groups that through their movements found and populated every continent and every island. Some 200,000 years ago, human societies, having originated in sub-Saharan Africa, began migrating in all directions, and their descendants eventually populated the globe. Around 12,000 years ago, some of these people began staying put and developing agriculture, gardening, horticulture. Many being women who domesticated wild plants and began cultivating others. As a birthplace of agriculture and the towns and cities that followed, America, the two continents, the whole Western Hemisphere, is ancient. It's not a new world. Domestication of plants took place around the globe in seven locales during approximately the same period, around 9,000 years ago. Three of these seven were in the Americas, all based on corn. The Valley of Mexico, which includes Central America, Mesoamerica, the South Central Andes in South America, and the eastern half of North America that is now the United States. The other early agricultural centers were the Tigris-Euphrates and Nile River systems, sub-Saharan Africa, the Yellow River of northern China, and the Yangtze River of southern China. During this time, many of the same human societies began domesticating animals. Only in the American continents was the parallel domestication of animals eschewed in favor of a form of game management, a kind of animal husbandry different from that that developed in Africa and Asia. In these seven areas, agricultural-based societies developed in symbiosis with hunting, fishing, and gathering peoples, gradually interchanging with each other, creating trade routes and interrelationships. Indigenous American agriculture was based on corn. Traces of cultivated corn have been identified in central Mexico dating back 10,000 years. 12 to 14 centuries later, corn production had spread throughout the temperate and tropical areas of the Americas, from the southern tip of South America to the subarctic of North America, and from the Pacific to the Atlantic Oceans on both continents. The wild grain from which corn was cultivated has never been identified with certainty. But the indigenous peoples for whom grown corn was and is their sustenance believe it was a sacred gift from their gods. Since there is no evidence of corn on any other continent prior to its post-Columbus dispersal, its development is a unique and ancient invention of the original American agriculturalists. Along with multiple varieties of and colors of corn, Mesoamericans cultivated squash and beans, which were extended throughout the hemisphere. And they too came in many different colors and shapes and sizes, as were the many varieties and colors of potatoes cultivated by Andean farmers beginning more than 7,000 years ago. Corn, being a summer crop, can tolerate no more than 20 to 30 days without water, and even less in high temperatures. Many of the areas where corn was the staple were arid or semi-arid, so its cultivation required the design and construction of complex irrigation systems in place at least 2,000 years before Europeans knew that the Americas existed. The proliferation of agriculture could not have occurred without centuries of cultural and commercial interchange among the peoples of North, Central, South America, and the Caribbean, whose traders carried seeds as well as other goods and cultural practices. The vast reach and capacity of indigenous grain production impressed colonialist Europeans. A traveler in French-occupied North America related in 1669 that 6 square miles of cornfields surrounded each Iroquois village. The governor of New France, following a military raid in the 1680s, reported that he had destroyed more than a million bushels, 42,000 tons of corn, belonging to 4 Iroquois villages. Thanks to the nutritious triad of corn, beans, and squash, which provide a complete protein, the Americans were densely populated when the European monarchies began sponsoring colonization projects here. The total population of the hemisphere was about 100 million at the end of the 15th century, with about 2/5 in North America, including Mexico. Central Mexico alone supported some 30 million people. At the same time, the population of Europe as far east as the Ural Mountains was around 50 million. Experts have observed that such population densities in pre-colonial America were supportable because it was a relatively disease-free paradise. But there certainly were diseases and health problems. At least there were cures for them, so apparently there were problems. But the practice of herbal medicine and even surgery and dentistry, and most importantly, both hygienic and ritual bathing, kept diseases at bay. Settler observers in all parts of the Americas marveled at the frequent bathing, even in winter in cold climates. One commented that native people go to the river and plunge in and wash themselves before they dress daily. Another wrote, "Men, women, and children from early infancy are in the habit of bathing." This is quite shocking to Europeans who never bathe. That's why they had so many diseases. Ritual sweat baths were common to all native North Americans, having originated in Mexico. Above all, the majority of the indigenous peoples of the Americas had healthy, mostly vegetarian diets based on the staple of corn and supplemented by wild fish, fowl, and four-legged animals. People lived long and well with abundant ceremonial and recreational periods. In some place, one place I study, but I don't think it's that unusual, the Pueblos of New Mexico, they still recognize, but they can't carry it out, 200 of the 365 days a year were ceremonial days. Can you imagine that much leisure in our society? As on the two other major continental landmasses, Eurasia and Africa, civilization in the Americas emerged from certain population centers with periods of vigorous growth and integration, interspersed with periods of decline and disintegration. At least a dozen such centers were functioning in the Americas when the Europeans intervened. And although this book is a history of the part of North America that is today the United States, it is important to follow the corn to its origins and consider the people's histories of the Valley of Mexico and Central America. Influences from the South powerfully shaped indigenous peoples to the North and what is now the United States. And Mexicans continue to migrate as they have for a millennium, but now across the border that was established in the U.S. war against Mexico in 1846. So I'm going to skip most of the part about the rest of the Americas. You have to read the book to get that. And just come to the closest, Mexico, on the dawn, you know, on the edge of Spanish colonization. This is when the economic basis for the powerful Aztec nation was hydraulic agriculture, with corn as the central crop. Beans, pumpkins, tomatoes, cacao, and many other food crops flourished and supported a dense population, much of it concentrated in large urban centers. The Aztecs also grew tobacco and cotton, the latter providing the fiber for all cloth and clothing. Weaving and metalwork flourished, providing useful commodities as well as works of art made out of gold and silver. Building techniques enabled construction of enormous stone dams and canals, as well as fortress-like castles made of brick or stone. There were elaborate markets in each city and a far-flung trade network that used routes established by the Toltecs. The Aztecs came down from the north, what is today Utah and northern New Mexico, Arizona, migrated down and then became dominant. Aztec merchants acquired turquoise from pueblos in New Mexico who mined it to sell in central Mexico, where it had become the most valued of all material possessions and was used as a means of exchange or a form of money. 65,000 turquoise artifacts can be found in Chaco Canyon, New Mexico, have been dug up there, and are evidence of the importance of turquoise as a major pre-colonial item. Other items were also valuable in the area, salt being close to turquoise in value. And both salt and turquoise were free for anyone to go and mine and acquire. It wasn't controlled by the state or by anyone. Ceramic trade goods involved interconnected markets from Mexico City to Mesa Verde, Colorado. Shells from the Gulf of California, tropical bird feathers from the Gulf Coast area of Mexico, obsidian from Durango, Mexico, and flint from Texas were all found in the ruins of Casa Grande, which is in today's Arizona. It was the commercial center of the northern frontier of the Aztec Empire. Turquoise functioning as money was traded to acquire macaw and parrot feathers from tropical areas for religious rituals, seashells from coastal peoples, and hides and meat from the northern plains. The stone turquoise has been found in pre-colonial sites in Texas, Kansas, and Nebraska, where the Wichita people served as intermediaries, carrying turquoise and other goods farther east and north. Crees in the Lake Superior region and communities in what is today Ontario, Canada, and in today's Wisconsin acquired turquoise through trade. Traders from Mexico were also transmitters of culture with features like the Sundance religion that was brought up into the Great Plains, and the cultivation of corn by the Algonquin, Cherokee, Muscogee Creek peoples of the eastern half of North America were transmitted from Central America, from the Valley of Mexico. The oral and written histories of the Aztecs, Cherokees, and Choctaws record these relations. Cherokee oral history tells of their ancestors' migrations from the south and through Mexico, as does Muscogee history. Although Aztecs were apparently flourishing culturally and economically, as well as being militarily and politically strong, their dominance was declining on the eve of Spanish intrusion. Being pressed for tribute through violent attacks, peasants rebelled against the Aztecs, and there were uprisings all over Mexico. Montezuma II, who came to power in 1503, might have succeeded in his attempt to reform the regime, to decentralize was his plan. But the Spanish overthrew him before he had the opportunity and burned down the capital city. The Mexican nation was crushed and its cities leveled in Cortez's three-year genocidal war. Cortez's recruitment of resistant communities all over Mexico as allies aided in toppling the central regime. Cortez and his 200 European mercenaries could never have overthrown the Mexican state without the indigenous insurgency they co-opted. The resistant peoples who allied with Cortez to overthrow the oppressive Aztec regime could not yet have known the goals of the gold-obsessed Spanish colonizers or the European institutions that backed them, because they had already been busy for seven centuries in pushing the Moors and the Jews out of the Iberian Peninsula and creating all of the institutions they used to colonize in Mexico and Peru. They had already developed in that process in Spain itself. What is now the U.S. Southwest, once formed with today's Mexican states of Sonora, Sinaloa, and Chihuahua, the northern periphery of the Aztec regime in the Valley of Mexico. Mostly an alpine, arid, and semi-arid region cut with rivers, it is a fragile land base with rainfall a scarce commodity and drought endemic. Yet in the Sonora Desert of present-day southern Arizona, communities were practicing agriculture some 2,500 years ago and began digging irrigation canals as early as 1,400 years ago. The earliest evidence of corn in the area dates from 2,500 years ago, introduced by trade and migration between north and south. Farther north, people began cultivating corn, beans, squash, and cotton around 2,000 years ago. Their descendants, the Otom people, who used to be called Pimas, call their ancestors the Huhugam, meaning those who have gone before, which English speakers have rendered as Hohokam. The Hohokam people left behind ball courts similar to those of the Mayans, multi-story buildings, and agricultural fields. Their most striking imprint on the land is one of the most extensive networks of irrigation canals in the world at that time. From the years 900 to 1450 in the current era, the Hohokams built a canal system of more than 800 miles of trunk lines and hundreds more miles of branches serving local sites. The longest known canal extended 20 miles. The largest were 75 to 85 feet in diameter and 20 feet deep, and many were leak-proof, lined with clay. One canal system carried enough water to irrigate an estimated 10,000 acres. Hohokam farmers grew surplus crops for export, and their community became a crossroads in a trade network reaching from Mexico to Utah and from the Pacific coast to New Mexico and into the Great Plains. By the 14th century, the Hohokams had dispersed, living in smaller communities. You'll see a pattern here as I go through this of the decentralization. It seemed to me, if I've looked at this a lot for a long time, and that this was intentional. I know it's Jared Diamond, others portray it as catastrophe, as collapse. But I think the Americans, the Native Americans of the hemisphere, were going in a different direction than European went in. So trying to take away the Eurocentric way of looking at this, you find this constant devolution once things get too big, and decentralization. I think that's what was happening with the Aztecs. So that happened in the Chaco Canyon area. And in their oral history, the Pueblo Indians are their descendants. They tell the story of having built up too much because all these canals and everything required wood, and they had denuded. They had made their habitat inhabitable. So they moved, and then they moved into, they built 98 small city-states along the Rio Grande, much more modest configuration of their. They kept the same economy, but it was a very different. To this day, they still haven't depleted. They haven't depleted that area. Other people have. But they thrived up there for about 500 years. So these ancestors of the Pueblos had constructed themselves 400 miles of roads radiating out from Chaco, averaging 30 feet wide. These roads followed straight courses, even through difficult terrain such as hills and rock formations. The highways connected some 75 communities. And then in the ancient Pueblos, abandoned Chaco area migrated. So northernmost Taos Pueblo became an important trade center, handling buffalo products from the plains, tropical bird products, copper and shell from Mexico, and turquoise from the New Mexico mines. Pueblo trade extended as far west as the Pacific Ocean, and as far east as the Great Plains, and as far south as Central America. From the Atlantic Ocean to the Mississippi River and south to the Gulf of Mexico lay one of the most fertile agricultural belts in the world, crisscrossed with great rivers, naturally watered, teeming with plant and animal life, temperate in climate. The region was home to multiple agricultural nations, and this is one of those seven origins of agricultural civilization. In the 12th century, the Mississippi Valley was marked by one enormous city-state, Cahokia, and several large ones built of earthen stepped pyramids, much like those in Mexico. Cahokia supported a population of tens of thousands, larger than that of London during the same period. Other architectural monuments were sculpted in the shape of gigantic birds, lizards, bears, alligators, and even a 1,300-foot long serpent. These feats of monumental construction testify to the levels of civil and social organization. Called demeaningly mound builders by European settlers, the peoples of this civilization had dispersed before the European invasion. See, they decentralized too. But their influence spread throughout the eastern half of North American continent through cultural influences and trade. What European colonizers found in the southeastern region of the continent were nations of villages with economies based on agriculture and corn, the mainstay. This was the territory of the nations of the Cherokee, Chickasaw, and Choctaw in the Muscogee Creek and Seminole, along with the Natchez Nation in the western part, the Mississippi Valley region. Those people, by the way, no longer exist as a nation because the Spanish got there first, and before the transatlantic slave trade was in place, the Indians were, the first century of Spanish colonization, Indians were captured for slaves, and they were deported to the mines of Peru. So they didn't do a die-off. They were actually, like West Africa, raided for slaves and transported to Peru to work in the mines. So that was one of the largest of the nations there in the southeast. To the north, a remarkable federal state structure, the Haudenosaunee Confederacy, often referred to as the Six Nations of the Iroquois Confederacy, was made up of the Seneca, Cayuga, Onondaga, Oneida, and Mohawk nations. And from early in the 19th century, the Tuscaroras joined the Federation. This system incorporated six widely dispersed and unique nations, with each with different languages, of thousands of agricultural villages and hunting grounds from the Great Lakes and the St. Lawrence River to the Atlantic and as far south as the Carolinas and inland to Pennsylvania. The Haudenosaunee peoples avoided centralized power by means of a clan village system of democracy based on collective stewardship of the land. Corn, the staple crop, was stored in granaries and distributed equitably in this matrilineal society by the clan mothers, the oldest woman from every extended family. Many other nations flourished in the Great Lakes region, where now the U.S.-Canadian border cuts through their realms, among them the Anishinaabe Nation, otherwise called Ojibwe and Chippewa, and still called that, but their overall name is Anishinaabe. And that was the largest. The peoples of the prairies of Central North America spanned an expanse of space from West Texas to the subarctic between the Mississippi River and the Rocky Mountains. Several centers of development in that vast region of farming and bison-dependent people may be identified. In the prairies of Canada, the Crees, of course. In the Dakotas, the Lakota and Dakota Sioux. And to their west and south, the Cheyenne and Arapaho peoples. Farther south were the Ponca, Pawnee, Osage, Kiowa, many other nations, with buffalo numbering 60 million. Territorial disputes inevitably occurred. These are human communities. And diplomatic skills, as well as trade, were highly developed for conflict resolution. In the Pacific Northwest, from present-day Alaska to San Francisco, and along the vast inland waterways to the mountain barriers, great seafaring and fishing peoples flourished, linked by culture, common ceremonies, and extensive trade. These were wealthy people living in a comparative paradise of natural resources, including the sacred salmon. They crafted gigantic wooden totems, masts, and lodges carved from giant sequoias, redwoods, and cedar. Among these communities speaking many languages were the Tlingit people of Alaska, the salmon fishing Salish, Makah, Hoopa, Pomo, Karak, and Yurok peoples, many more. In the territory between the Sierra Nevada and Rocky Mountains in the west, now called the Great Basin, was a harsh environment that supported small populations before European colonization, as it does today. Yet the Shoshone, Bannock, Paiute, and Ute peoples there managed the environment and built permanent villages. So I'm skipping a whole section called governance, which is very interesting. But I do take up part of that just to talk about the role of women. The roles of women varied a lot in the Americas because the societies were organized in many, many different ways. I say what they have in common is all around the collective, around the community, the good of the community, and for everyone to be served. But most of them had in common also being matriarchal or matrilineal. And I try to clarify that it's kind of a tricky word, matriarchy, because we have the word patriarchy. And matriarchy isn't just a woman pyramid like patriarchy. Matriarchy is really democracy. So the stronger the natural way of human beings, the matriarchy creates a democracy. So this was certainly true, especially among the Haudenosaunee. And the Haudenosaunee were also becoming influential in a very large area, would most likely have developed into a federation of all of the east of the Mississippi, because you find elements, but they had developed very a constitution among themselves for governance, and certain female lineages controlled the choice of representatives for their clans in the governing councils. And of course, marriage, the woman decided the marriage and divorce. I don't know if any of you have read Charles Mann's book, 1491. Has anyone read that? It's really, really an interesting book. He's a science writer, so a very good writer. So he put together an enormous amount of research on all of the Americas. But he calls the Haudenosaunee a feminist dream. According to the value system that drove consensus building and decision making in all these societies, the community's interest overrode individual interests. After every member of a council had his or her say, any member who considered a decision incorrect might nevertheless agree to abide by it for the sake of the community's cohesion. In the rare cases in which consensus could not be reached, the segment of the community represented by dissenters might withdraw from the community and move away to found a new community. this was certainly the practice of the Pueblos in New Mexico, which was halted when the Spanish came. They froze in place. 98 city-states that could no longer have that flexibility that they had before colonization. So by the time of the European invasions, indigenous peoples had occupied and shaped every inch of the Americas, established extensive trade networks and roads, and were sustaining their populations by adapting to specific natural environments. But they also adapted nature to suit the community ends. Indigenous peoples used fire to shape and tame the pre-colonial North American landscape. In the Northeast, indigenous farmers always carried flints. They also used torches for night hunting and rings of flame to encircle animals. Rather than domesticating animals for hides and meat, indigenous communities created havens to attract elk, deer, bear, and other game. They burned the undergrowth and forests so that the young grasses and other ground cover that sprouted the following spring would entice greater numbers of herbivores and their predators that fed on them, which would sustain the people. So we have this romantic image, romanticize the romantic, romantic idea of the native person out in the woods hunting all the time, the last of the Mohicans. Actually, they brought the animals to them. Why exert so much when you're a human being? So there's, it was their kind of animal husbandry. So rather than the thick, unbroken, monumental snarl of trees imagined by Thoreau, the Great Eastern Forest was an ecological kaleidoscope of garden plots, blackberry rambles, pine barrens, and spacious groves of chestnut, hickory, and oak. Inland, a few miles from the shore of present-day Rhode Island, an early European explorer marveled at the trees that were spaced so that the forest could be penetrated even by a large army. See what they had on their mind. English mercenary John Smith wrote that he had ridden a galloping horse through the Virginia forest. In Ohio, the first English squatters on indigenous lands in the mid-18th century encountered forested areas that resembled English parks as they could drive carriages through the trees. Bison herds roamed the east from New York to Georgia. It's no accident that a settler city in western New York was named Buffalo. The American bison was indigenous to the northern and southern plains of North America, not to the east. Yet native peoples imported them east along a path of fire as they transformed forest into fallows for the bison to survive upon, far from their original habitat. Historian William Cronin has written that when the Haudenosaunee hunted buffalo, they were harvesting foodstuffs which they had consciously been instrumental in creating. As for the Great American Desert, as Anglo-Americans call the Great Plains, the occupants transformed that too into game farms. Using fire, they extended the giant grasslands and maintained them. When Lewis and Clark began their trek up the Missouri River in 1804, ethnologist Dale Lott observes, they beheld not a wilderness, but a vast pasture managed by and for Native Americans. So Native Americans created the world's largest gardens and grazing lands and thrived. They left an indelible print on the land with systems of roads that tied nations and communities together across the entire landmass of the Americas. Roads were developed along rivers, and many indigenous roads in North America tracked the Mississippi, Ohio, Missouri, Columbia, and Colorado rivers, the Rio Grande, and other major streams. Roads also followed seacoasts. A major road still exists today. It's called Highway 1, or Pan American Highway. This road along the Pacific coast from northern Alaska, where travelers could continue by boat to Siberia, south to an urban area in western Mexico. A branch of that road ran through the Sonora Desert and up onto the Colorado Plateau, serving ancient towns and later communities such as those of the Hopi and Pueblos. From the Pueblo communities, roads eastward carried travelers onto the semi-arid plains along tributaries of the Pecos River and up to the communities in what is now eastern New Mexico, the Texas Panhandle, and West Texas. There were also roads from the northern Rio Grande to the southern plains of western Oklahoma by way of the Canadian and Cimarron Rivers. The roads along those rivers and their tributaries led to a system of roads that followed rivers from the southeast. They also connected with ones that turned southward toward the Valley of Mexico and beyond. The eastern roads connected the Muscogee Creek towns in present-day Georgia and Alabama. From the Muscogee towns, a major road led north through Cherokee territory, the Cumberland Gap, and the Shenandoah Valley region to the confluence of the Ohio and Scioto rivers. From that northeastern part of the continent, a traveler could reach the west coast by following roads along the Ohio River to the Mississippi, up the Mississippi Road to the mouth of the Missouri, and along the Missouri westward to its headwaters. From there, a road crossed the Rocky Mountains through South Pass in present-day Wyoming and led to the Columbia River. The Columbia River Road led to the large population, a very large population center at the river's mouth on the Pacific Ocean and connected with that Pacific Coast Road, Pan American Highway. So all of the highways that have been were not created. It's important to know that the Europeans did not come to a wilderness. They appropriated civilizations. They could never have grown so wealthy had they not simply taken what was already there and used what was already there. So, to end this, back to corn. You notice in all of this, I've never once mentioned the Bering Straits, and that's very intentional, as I have a different paradigm, and that's follow the corn for migrations and see where that takes you, instead of the Bering Straits theory of populating the Americas. So North America in 1492 was not a virgin wilderness, but a network of indigenous nations, the peoples of the corn, peoples of the salmon. The link between peoples of the North and South can be seen in the diffusion of corn from Mesoamerica. Both Muscogees and Creeks, whose original homelands in North America are located in the Southeast, trace their lineage to migrations from or through Mexico. Cherokee historian Emmett Starr wrote, "The Cherokees most probably preceded by several hundred years the Muscogees in their exodus from Mexico and swung in a wider circle, crossing the Mississippi River many miles north of the mouth of the Missouri River, as indicated by the mounds." Another Cherokee writer, Robert Conley, tells about the oral tradition that claims Cherokee origins in South America and subsequent migrations through Mexico. Later, with U.S. military invasions and relocations of the Muscogee and Cherokee peoples, many groups split off and sought refuge in Mexico, as did others under pressure, such as the Kickapoos. So this is tomorrow is Cinco de Mayo, so I thought I would mention that colonialism cut all these peoples off from each other. You can see they were all networked and knitted together, whole two continents of civilization with intimate relations and interchanges, people speaking many different languages, but some lingua franca, like Nahuatl, was common, like Swahili in parts of Africa, trade languages, and sign language was very important all over the Western Hemisphere. And all these peoples were cut off from each other. And of course, especially for North America, being cut off from sort of the mother source of Central Mexico. But what we see today, and if anyone wants to ask about it, I can talk about this a lot, is this indigenous movement, this hemispheric indigenous movement, and Pacific, because this goes on, you know, the trade was also across the Pacific with the Polynesian, Melanesian peoples, and among themselves, that these relations are being reestablished. And this is my hope for the future, that we have a reconfiguration and kind of go back and look at where history went wrong. I'm trying to defeat the idea of progress, that what we have now is progress, that something went wrong with the way Europe developed. And I think you can trace it, and I do in chapter 2 of this book, The Culture of Conquest. And I think it took the whole world in another direction, and that if we can look back and find the threads here in this hemisphere to reconnect to, and the memories are still there, and the practices are still there. They may be reduced in form because of colonialism, but the basic elements are still there to build upon. Well, thank you. Michelle is asking about the resistance to colonization and just how it worked. And that's a large part of this book, of course, is the resistance. Sometimes survival itself at certain periods, especially between 1890 and 1940 or so in the United States, is survival itself is resistance. But in the beginning, the resistance was getting to know who these people were and what their intentions were, because at least the Anglo, you know, the British traders came first. And you see, Native people were traders. You know, we find in Virginia copper from the Great Lakes area, and many items made out of copper. Exchange items all over the place and all down into Mexico and, of course, up into Canada. And so these, at first, the Norwegians had come, the Vikings had come over from Iceland and set up some trade centers, and then they left. I mean, they didn't have the intention of conquest. They came to trade, no problem. And so when these people came to trade, and who knows what other traders came, because the assumption is there was never any relationship between, say, Africa and Brazil. That's hard for me to believe, because that's a really pretty short distance, and they had boats, you know. So it's like only Europeans know how to boat, you know, get on the water, have the courage to get out on the ocean. So, I mean, we do know the Arctic people, of course, were all over the place in their kayaks, all over the polar area. So the first resistance was, you know, immediately when they came ashore, and that was in Jamestown, the first colony. The people there were farmers. They were not... They were not warring with anyone else, and they they were pretty, they had been trading offshore too. So this was when they came and landed and wanted to set up their, you know, a little colony. It was from the beginning in Virginia, very violent entrance. And a part of this I go through in, you know, in the culture of conquest, these like John Smith being a good example of, I call him a mercenary, but he had just come from the wars and, you know, in Turkey, the British wars, invasions, because these were the Crusades continuing, the Christian Europe against the Muslims. And these were looting wars, you know, they were taking items, killing people, anti-civilian, just populations, not standing armies. And this went on for 8 centuries, you know, this, the Crusades. And so he comes just, you know, still with a gunpowder on him from the Turkish wars. And it's just a brutal kind of, you know, forced settlement there, right in the middle of the native territory. So the response of the native people was to try to find some kind of diplomatic, you know, relationship, and they captured, Pocahontas, held her hostage, and, you know, this, it was a, but finally they had a big rebellion, and they really destroyed the because there's no way this colony could survive without that. They were simply going out and brutalizing people and taking the corn and taking the food, stealing it. Whereas had they come and behaved, they would have fed them, you know. I mean, if they were hungry, or taught them how to plant crops. So that colony was a miserable failure at first. So we don't talk about that much in U.S. history. So we go up to the good colony, the Puritans and the Massachusetts Bay, and this is what we romanticize, but they were every bit as brutal. They were just more numerous. They also were more hardworking. They were these, you know, hardworking Puritans, and most of them had come from agricultural backgrounds or a cottage industry. They were they weren't just looking for gold. They basically were looking for gold in Virginia, and they have found some, you know. But they had come as religious dissidents. But remember, they had come as a corporation. And so really the United States was founded as a corporation. I always, you know, when I hear that, the corporation and the state, you know, and the relationship, I say, the United States is a corporation. You know, that's really how it was founded. It doesn't necessarily deserve to be called a nation or a republic. It's a corporation. It's a big corporation. And that, you know, oversees all the little corporations. And so it's not a contradiction. And these people were brought to be the kind of, you know, given the passage over, and they had to sign contracts with the corporate body that they would produce a certain amount. The Spanish had the same deal. You had to make the colony productive, or you couldn't keep it, and had to become self-sufficient. So how do they do this? They steal the crops of the... This was very, you know, very highly developed gardens and of course the fisheries and all. So they basically took, again, simply stole the food supplies. And I told you the Haudenosaunee and all the people they influenced had granaries. They used granaries. This was different than the Southeast. So they would take that food. But also burn crops and to make, you know, to force the native people to the periphery. But a few years of that, and the Pequot, who were the main people affected, rose up in a huge resistance movement that probably guaranteed their survival, but nevertheless put them on the margins of the colony that kept developing. So that's the way it went with the first 13 colonies, the 13 colonies where they strip along the Atlantic Ocean. That's what became the United States. So the history of the United States is how it got from there, to there. So I call that the West. That's where the West began, not at the Mississippi River, not in New Mexico, not in California. It began right there. The west to the east. And so it's all a it's all a settler state story from the very beginning. And then they keep pushing. So the Boers, in every case, there was resistance. There were various kinds of resistance in the colonial period. The appeal to colonial authorities, for instance, in Virginia and the House of Burgess, these were British citizens, the colonies, they weren't Americans or US, they were British citizens. And they had, they were an upper class, especially in Virginia. And they actually, because of the resistance of the native people in Virginia, they made agreements, they made treaties, they made some agreements with with them, a kind of neat demarcation of land. So we have this, then these rebellions of poor whites and some free blacks against the House of Burgess because they won't send troops out to drive the Indians out to take their land. So you have very complicated situations of the colonial power supposedly, trying to protect, and especially this went on, they stabilized these 13 colonies. They had them fully under control and had pushed, but the great populations of native people were still there. It was the frontier, was the Appalachian Mountains and the Allegheny Mountains. This was it. And then after the French and Indian War in 1754 ended, the British made a proclamation in the agreement with France. Britain won, but France could have kept fighting, so the Treaty of Paris. They made a proclamation that they agreed that there would be no settlement beyond the mountain range, ever. It would be Indian country. The French would not colonize it, and the British would not colonize it. And that is why I think the settlers revolted to be independent, because they were already, they actually sent redcoats out to force them to come back, because they were squatting in the Ohio Valley. So the very first document they wrote after declaring independence was the Northwest Ordinance. Where's the Northwest? You think you live in the Northwest, don't you? The Northwest was Ohio. That's why they called it the Northwest Ordinance. And they were already, they plotted out there. They've been surveying. Washington was a surveyor. George Washington was a surveyor. They were all surveyors. It sounds like a lowly task, but you get the best land by being the surveyor. And they were all into speculation, land speculation, the founding fathers and settlers. That was everyone's aspiration. Get land, invite more settlers in, and sell the land. And so that, and then by then the highly developed plantation slavery system was in place. So when the United States became independent, it was then, you know, an immediate push to expand the plantation agriculture because they had ruined Virginia, Georgia, you know, they had monocrops, more land. And that was the removal then that led to the removal of all of the native people east of the Mississippi. But yeah, there were three declared wars, all Seminole, they were called Seminole Wars, between 1815 and 1852. Unrelenting warfare against the people who held out and refused to be relocated in the Florida Everglades. So all of the dissidents from different nations, the Shawnee and the Creeks and all, as they would get pushed back and get steamrolled, basically how the U.S. settlers and the U.S. Army that formed, they used a counterinsurgency, which means attacking the civilians, burning their crops and their food supplies. Starve is called food fight, and they called it a food fight then. And that way, people would have to become refugees. And that way, you know, all kinds of the conditions of refugees. This is a constant warfare. Anytime you have warfare, you have refugees and under terrible conditions and of dependency. So they would make treaties then where the United States would promise to provide food, but then they're in a dependency relationship. And generally those were not obeyed. So there was always resistance. The armed resistance is marked, the ending of it is, some went on after that, but it's sort of symbolically marked with the Wounded Knee Massacre of 1890. And that was just, it's called a battle in U.S. Army annals. It was the 7th Cavalry, it was Custer's old cavalry, and it was kind of a revenge for the Little Bighorn, his former troops. But it was, the attack was on refugees in the middle of winter, mostly people very sick and starving who were actually coming through a snowstorm to turn themselves into the government to get food for the, as they were starving. And the 7th Cavalry surrounded them. The Hotchkiss guns were sort of like the early day machine guns, rapid fire, and just mowed, you know, 300 people, some 300 people down. So that's, they call that a battle, one of the successful battles of their battle streamers. There were 30 Congressional Medals of Honor given to the soldiers who did this. So that's a battle. So yeah, the resistance, the armed resistance, then after that, the resistance mainly has been in the courts and in more recently, getting, you know, winning over some advocates. I think after, there's this period in the early 20th century that's very interesting of, I know my grandfather was involved on my father's side with the Socialist Party and the Industrial Workers of the World. But there were a lot of people who began, you know, looking at the situation, were more sympathetic with a Native situation. Very few, I would say, but in the 1920s, quite a little group of people formed in New Mexico around Taos. D.H. Lawrence was there, and this, you know, George O'Keefe went there, and there were these women's clubs, because the women's right to vote was a long, long process, and it built up to a huge movement. And these women's clubs had formed all over the United States. So after they got the vote, they turned toward different projects. And one of the projects of the San Francisco women's group was to assist the Pueblo Indians in their land claims, trying to get their land back. So they actually went through Congress in 1922 and got a lot, not all, but a lot of the land that had been lost since the United States took over that area. And out of that came John Collier, a young anthropologist in San Francisco, who they hired to go down and run that program. And he then got appointed by Roosevelt, Franklin Roosevelt, as Commissioner of Indian Affairs. And kind of, you know, the way the New Deal was working is Roosevelt would just kind of put someone in charge, and then they kind of had carte blanche, you know, and did a lot of creative things that were not like top-down ordered, but just, you know, it was just too desperate a situation during the Depression to know what would work or not. So they're just doing all kinds of things. And so that so-called New Deal for Indians was it's a mixed bag, but certainly John Collier was a very dedicated person. He's one of the early people who, one of the first U.S. citizens who ever recognized that these were nations of people. These weren't just straggling so-called Indians, that they were Taos people, and they were Mojave people, and they were Ponca and Pawnee and Navajo, you know, that they were nations of people. And he had developed this whole living there at Taos when he was doing this program. He had become very impressed with their form of government, the Pueblo's form of government, the by then 19 Pueblos, the Spanish destroyed about 80 of them, how they had this federation, All Indian Pueblo Council, but the way democracy worked with it. He was absolutely fascinated with it. And it was the only thing he knew well, and it was really good, but it was a different form of government than, say, the Navajos had, or the Sioux. Or so he kind of developed a plan for, that came to be the Indian Reorganization Act, that would set up governments. See, that's when it becomes top-down. They had their own democratic government, the Taos people, or the Pueblos did. But kind of to impose this form of government on all of the different nations. So it's kind of, you know, overall policy of one size fits all. And so it had a lot of negative, plus it got watered down. It was 1934, and it was a little too radical for Congress, so some of his elements, but he did keep several important things in. One was self-determination, and that was that no Native nation had to join the Indian Reorganization Act. They could stay outside of it. They weren't forced to, but if they did, it had to be this kind of form, pattern. And so for all of those people, tribal governments formed under the Indian Reorganization Act, they really kind of found the people who could speak English, the more often those were Mormons in the Southwest, Mormon converts. And it developed a kind of tribal government that was separate from the traditional government. So Wounded Knee Uprising in 1973 was about that, the tribal government giving away land and being very corrupt and very dictatorial, and the traditional government not having any acknowledgement or say in governance. So it created problems, but on the other hand, it ended allotment, because allotment had become the policy in the 1880s. and three-fourths of Indian treaty land was lost under allotment. And that was stopped. The land wasn't restored, but allotment was stopped. But only 20 years later, Congress switched completely to, under the Eisenhower administration, to the Termination Act. Terminate all Native people, do away with the land base, do away with it, Native status. So that's what brought the new uprising that is still with us, has sustained itself. And that started in the 1950s, and most people didn't become very aware of it until the fish-ins up here. But that was, this was a long time coming, these struggles building up and leadership developing. And then there was the, of course, the Alcatraz, a very symbolic thing, but very important in educational and consciousness raising. It lasted 18 months. And especially for Native, young Native people from Canada, the US, all over, it made pilgrimage. It was sort of a place you could come and learn, you know, and so local leadership developed all over the country. And at that same time, the American Indian Movement was born. And other organizations existed before that that were like the National Indian Youth Council and the, of course, the Survival for American Indians up here in Washington.
What do you have to say about Wovoka and the ghost dances, various incarnations of the ghost dances? I'd be interested in hearing what you have to say about that.
Yeah, the ghost dance. This is what Wounded Knee, the massacre, supposedly, they wanted the people to stop dancing. They had already outlawed all of the ceremonies of all of the Native people. The sun dance was outlawed. Every ceremony was outlawed. And the missionaries, of course, Christian missionaries, policed it very closely and told on people if they were told the government, and then they would come and arrest the people who were practicing religion. So, and the other thing, in the Indian Wars in the Plains and in the Southwest, the buffalo, the bison people, the plains people, the herdsmen who moved from place to place, they had sacred items they carried with them. They carried their religion with them, although there was sacred territory like the Black Hills, certain geographies that certain things had to be practiced. But the first thing make war on a encampment or a village, they would zero in on who the keeper of the, you know, the medicine person, the keeper, and kill that person and take those objects away. And so they were supposed to burn them, but they turned up later in Smithsonian and, you know, different museums around the world. We're still trying to get them back. But these would be medicine bags, generally medicine bags, that were, you know, the heart of the religion. And so that's like, you know, burning all the libraries in a Western, you know, this is the knowledge base that's carried on. And they very purposely would do that. So there were two pan-Indian religions that developed. One was the ghost dance, and that was a prophecy from a Paiute Native person medicine man named Wovoka in Nevada. And if you look at how the ghost dance spread all the way up into Canada, all over west of the Mississippi, in a very short time, you know that there was this incredible kind of underground of, even in this most defeated period of time in the 1880s, that they were still communicating with each other, because they started making pilgrimages, different medicine people, to Wovoka. Wovoka never went anywhere. They came to him, and he taught them the ghost dance, and they would take it back. And so Sitting Bull introduced it in Pine Ridge in the Lakota country. And it was a very simple, but since they didn't have their religious items anymore, they had nothing, it required nothing except a shirt that was not even it's the ribbon shirt you see the AIM people wearing. It's just a feed sack, you know, cloth with ribbons. It was nothing special, but it was christened a ghost shirt. It was a ghost shirt because you believed it was a ghost shirt. And you made your own. I mean, it's not like they were manufactured somewhere and handed out, you know. But it was, then he taught them the dance, which was basically just to keep dancing. And the point was to keep the spirits of the people up, but also that they're dancing with all the mostly young men, but anyone killed who died abnormally, that was killed by soldiers, killed in the wars, and to bring those warriors back among themselves if they danced. And they imagined, to give themselves courage, I guess, to keep resisting, that the ghost shirt would prevent bullets from killing them. And it did work in that way, because the army and what to make of this. Here are these people half starved, incarcerated, you know, with fences and guards, I mean, military incarceration. And they couldn't get them to stop dancing. They would dance day and night, and you know, people would rest, but there's always people dancing, taking turns. And so this was why they wouldn't assassinated Sitting Bull, because they thought he was giving the orders, and of course he wasn't. It was a collective thing. And that's why they that was their excuse for the massacre at Wounded Knee, was to stop this rebellion. They saw it as a rebellion, even though they had no arms whatsoever, you know, to fight with. This is considered a rebellion. So that ghost dance spread all over, and it was, that's what I mean by survival. You know, this is a resistance, survival resistance. And to keep together as a people, you know. And so what I found too is the stories that come from that, you know, as also from generation to generation, it's important. The other religion that was developed during that same period of time was the Native American church. It came to be called the Peyote. And that was from Sonora, Mexico. Again, you have all these medicine men, you know, who all knew each other traditionally, and they traveled and they exchanged ideas. There was a lot of fusion of religions. And so that's the Peyote, some call it Peyote cult. It did win at the Supreme Court, the Southern Cheyenne. They kept getting busted for using peyote. It was a restricted drug. So they went to the Supreme Court in 1913, and they won the right for it to be a Native American church religion. It's still very strong. It can exist side by side with Native religions, even Christianity or anything. It's not exclusive. It's a practice. And with Native American church, there's songs that are really songs of resistance that are, there were songs also with a ghost dance, and beautiful, mostly about a nation is coming, you know, our nation is going to heal. and the broken nation will come back and be whole again. So yeah, thank you for asking.
To write this in, where did you get a lot of the information from?
Well, as you can see, I'm old. So I've been researching and writing this for, I feel like I've been writing this book all my life almost, but for 40 years, you know, been working on different parts of what ended up in the book. Actually, nothing is unknown. It's really a reconfiguration of, you know, and a different narrative, a different perspective on what, you know, what is known. And I wanted as many Native voices as possible, so a lot of testimony in it, like the boarding school healing project, the testimony there is just heartbreaking. Listening, you know, to stories for the last 40 years, I felt like what I was doing, you know, because the idea of this book is, I was invited by a publisher to do this book, and it was their series of revisioning American history. And they're doing other books in this series. They wanted to do the indigenous one first. And it was the first time I'm not sure I would have thought of writing it, but they had this format, which was that it be a book that is readable by, you know, a moderately educated readership, you know, public, but not academic, but that it was scholarly enough that it could, it would be substantial, it has footnotes, and could be used in college courses, but also probably high school, and in general, you know, and could be read by the general public. So that's kind of hard, you know, and they want it to be, for all those reasons, also not 700 pages long, which to tell the history of the last 100,000 years seems like it take a little more than. So my word count was 90,000 words. Actually, it was 75,000, but I got by with 90,000. My first draft was three times that long, so the couple of years there just cutting, you know, and really. Wrote it over and over and over again to be a concise narrative, but it is it's well documented, and there are a few errors in the. It's gone through 8 printings, the hardback, and so some of those errors, you know, I keep finding them, and they are brought to my attention by my readership. I really appreciate it because there's some, you know, some dates wrong and stuff. As inevitably, but I think it's going to come out in paperback in August, and I made, you know, it's I think all the errors, of course they never are completely corrected, but it's well documented, it's substantial, and I've already had a lot of teachers are already using it, and college instructors, and finding it very, very useful as a general introduction, you know, to both the history of the United States, but also from the Native perspective. It was a tricky thing, you know, because it is a history of the United States. So I had to, first of all, grasp, and, you know, my training as a historian, you always have to do this historiography. And they wanted none of that because that's very boring to other people. That's when you're just trying to prove to other historians you're right. And they said, forget about the historians. Think about the people. And this was such a freedom, you know, that it was hard to grasp that, oh, I can write a whole book exactly what I think. So Someone had a hand up. Okay. Yeah.
Back in the beginning, you were talking about health and disease and pre-colonization. And I wonder if any studies have been done on average lifespan pre-colonization, and then compare those to places like you mentioned, London.
Yeah, the average age in Europe at that time was, you know, like about 32 years for women and 28 years for men, and it was probably double that in the Americas. You know, they don't say it much, but it is information that's available, you know, and you have to sometimes get into these rather esoteric archaeological journals to find this information. It doesn't make it into, you know, the history books, just this little detail of how healthy people were. Instead, they turn it around and say, oh, they were so susceptible to disease, like they were these delicate little creatures, you know, that the least germ would just knock them out rather than being made refugees and starved to death, you know. And of course, that's to avoid the charge of genocide. So they turn that paradise. That's why I say I made the point about it being, they say, oh, it was a disease-free paradise. No, it wasn't. They had bubonic plague in the Southwest. You know what they did when the plague happened? They would, the Pueblos, these city-states they built, if you've ever seen Taos, you know, these are substantial buildings, their apartment complexes, the way they lived. They would burn the town down, the first case, and move. That was the way they prevented diseases. Plus, a very healthy diet, bathing, sanitation, dentistry in this area in Northern California, there's evidence of dental work that was done and probably came from Mexico too. They had developed under the Toltecs possibly brain surgery, possibly eye surgery, and certainly dentistry. And of course, astronomy. I didn't even go into, you know, the scientific achievements. They knew the skies, everything that was there. They believed the sky was very powerful, which it is. If our sun does a supernova, we're crisp. So they prayed a lot to keep the sun. We should all be praying to keep the sun in its orbit. Yeah, so the lifespan was probably about what it is now in a developed country.
Earlier you were talking about this idea of communities like downsizing.
That's what seems to me to have been happening. I've looked, you know, where I've looked most deeply is in the Southwest and in Mexico. And of course, the Cahokia. But these are always portrayed. I always just had this doubt when I would hear about the collapse, that word collapse, civilizations building and collapsing. Because they don't say that about the Greek city-states, that they collapsed, you know. No, they morphed into Europe. So they never say that about anything except in the Western Hemisphere, this collapse thing. And I just doubted it. I said, well, maybe people were intentionally, if they went all that trouble to build the civilization, and I did in the literature, they look for everything possible. They look, were there weather patterns? Was there a meteor, you know, why did all those people leave the Mesa Verde? Why did the Mayans downsize from their gigantic civilization in Chiapas, Yucatan, Cantanaru, that all into Quiche and in northern, huge, huge area of large city-states, wealthy city-states. So it's called collapse, but they didn't cease to exist. they built smaller, they downsized, they probably had overused, as is clear with Mesa Verde, they had denuded, used too much wood, built too many big structures. But I think it was that, you know, these people were learning from their mistakes and starting over. And I think that's really something good to go back to those threads, I say, of that attitude toward things, you know, learning from our mistakes. And instead of just doing more of the same thing, more intensely, to draw back from it and say, let's look at another way of doing things. And I think it's just different. Different civilizations were arising in the Americas. That's why I think you have to start with the tragedy of the destruction of what we lost, what humanity lost, with these experiments that were going on in the Americas that were just stopped. But there's still the threads that are there, and I think it's really kept from us because this is, you know, people are here from everywhere, and they don't have access to this knowledge, you know, of the past, not just what happened, but the knowledge that people had at that time. They're learning, you know, through the environmental movement, but I think not always, because they pose this thing that civilization is contradictory to ecology. And I think the native peoples of the Americas disprove that they're not mutually exclusive. And so then it's hard to imagine if you accept that civilization is self-destructing, then it's hard to imagine, well, how do we live? So I think it limits our ability to explore ideas about how we could have cities. I mean, but not so big, you know. Lots of littler cities. Yes.
I was wondering, have you heard the 13 grandmothers and their pursuit?
I have heard of them, yeah.
Their pursuit to have audience with the Pope on this papal bull that was inaugurated around 1480 to 1490 to help the conquistadors, I believe, and their paradigm of health. I was just wondering how that would fit in with the landscape that you're bringing up, the political landscape, and even aspects of awakening of what we've done in the past. Steps, political steps that we'll take, are one so powerful. With the grandmother's song.
Yeah. And so what's the question?
The question is, can one weave that into this concept, not only resistance, but awakening?
Oh, yeah, I think so. You know, it's those kinds of projects have been going on for a long time. The White Roots of Peace of the Haudenosaunee in the 1950s and 60s, where they travel all around down into Mexico and Guatemala and up into Canada and all over. It's really good to see it be, those are mostly men at the time, medicine men and all, to see women, you know, the elder women, because they're really the, there's, you know, the colonization didn't just mean suppressing people, making them independent, but forcing upon them the consumer society and also suppression of women's power, you know, women's participation and power, and children for that matter. I think we should probably end. I'd be happy to sign books, and I'm sure then the workers in the library would like to get rid of us. Thank you all so much.